the 12th edition of the Jaipur Literature Festival. We are at Darbar Hall. We are delighted to introduce our new session, that is a Boundless Moment. Please welcome Paramita Satpathy in conversation with Namita S.Kalla. Can we give a huge round of applause for them, please?
Hi, good evening. Such a wonderful audience. Despite the cold breeze, I can see all of you here. And trust me, it is going to be worth it. Here I am, Namita S.Kalla, introducing Paramita Satpathy. Paramita started writing in 1985. That is when she wrote a short story. And there has been no stopping after that. She's also a Sahitya Akademi Award winner. And luckily, this book, A Boundless Moment, has won the award. And trust, this book has stories about women. And if someone said that a woman's heart is ocean of secrets, then they should meet her. And all of you all who want to know what are the secrets, then it is important that you either meet her or even better read her books, because trust me, you can get each and every secret, well, most of it, from this book. Before I start, there is one small incident that I would like to share. I got this book last night. I had been trying to fetch the book for quite a few days, but then couldn't get it. I got it last night, and not out of deliberation, but out of interest, I have not dropped the book till now, ever since last night. Talking about a boundless moment, let me read a few lines from the book. This is a translation from her Odia stories, right? So the translator puts it this way. She says, "A boundless moment is a moving account of a woman's craving for unalloyed love, of her longing for a gift of emotional abundance she believes would complete her persona and gain her the satisfaction of total fulfillment." Without taking much time, I'll move on to Paramita to share the details. Paramita, over to you.
Thank you, Namita. A very good evening to all of you. I know that it's a cold evening, and I'm very thankful that you all are here to listen to something about my book. This is a collection of novellas, you may say. 10 novellas is a little bigger book. And the first one, The Boundless Moment, the title novella, the title story, was written way back in 2010. And somehow, after publication of this story, people liked it so much that it really ushered me, it really inspired me to write few more, almost 9 more novellas on the different line, but with the same theme at the back of my mind. Obviously, as Namita has shared, that a woman is there behind all the stories, basically. Women in different from different strata, women in different situations, women, their psyche, delving into their psyches, and how they behaved in certain situations, what is their journey of life, what is their commitment to life. Those things I try to explore in the stories and with different protagonists, different situations, and different themes. A Boundless Moment, the title story, since Namita told me to talk a bit about it. This goes like this. There is the protagonist is a singer, and she is into a relationship with a person, a colleague of hers, who is very inspiring. It's a different kind of a relationship. It's not a kind of relationship, a man-woman relationship at all. Rather, they are meeting at a different plane, the plane of creativity. This is basically a creative friend or person who works along with her. So, as we all know, a woman who is creative has to face a lot of strife in life. Everybody may not be, but generally, this is what. Few days back, I had read a article of a famous Maithili writer has said कि अभी भी औरतें जो लिखते हैं उनके पति उनको censor करते हैं. So I mean these are some of the issues and facts I have got from life. Some from experience, some from others' experience, and some from imagination. I have woven it to a story. So this is, I would like to read a little bit for you from the title story. Yeah. So I'm reading from the middle of the story. A function was organized to felicitate me for receiving a state level award. The singer is getting the protagonist singer is getting a state level award. The function was followed by a dinner party. He too had been present on the occasion. I and my husband stood a little away from the bustling diners. The award may not be significantly great, but it grants a recognition. He made a passing remark. My husband turned. The hard lines of resentment gave his face a cruel, ugly look. Everything is about buy and sell nowadays. He shot back, his lips twisted in a frosty smile. I flushed visibly. My husband, as far as I knew him, was always decent and formal in a social gathering. It was, of course, another thing that, in the privacy of the house, he at times got transformed to a different man while venting out his displeasure. The caustic words he hissed through clenched jaws could peel the flesh off the bones. But this sort of a behavior in public, especially in his presence, was totally unexpected. What made him lose his cool? What made him counter his simple remark with such vehemence? Could he have guessed the intimacy of our relationship? Singing is Sima's passion, and I don't think she trades in her passion, he retaliated, looking straight in my husband's eyes. His reaction startled me even more than the disgracing comment of my husband. Surprisingly, my husband did not counter him, but the unpleasant incident had spoiled the evening for me. The words of my husband kept echoing in my mind all through the night. So, this is what my husband thinks of me. It is a pity that, despite the togetherness of all these years, he had not been able to look deep inside my emotions. It is really amazing that my life is tied up with a man who did not care to understand me in the minimum, and still more amazing that this togetherness will continue to survive the undercurrent of intolerance and envy with its usual and obvious pretense. I knew that my witty husband had hurt me purposely. Why? Is he so acutely averse to my singing? My thoughts moved still further back in time. I was the youngest child in the family, and that made me a bit more privileged. My father had not objected much when I told him I wished to learn singing. I had only sung in a few functions in school and college and in some other local cultural events. Father never dissuaded me from singing, nor did he encourage me ever. During the ritual visit to my parents' house on the seventh day of my marriage, I had told my mother that I wanted to take the harmonium, the tabla, and the tanpura to my in-law's house. Does our son-in-law have no objection to your singing, dear? She had asked me, looking a little unsure. Why should he? I had asked. It's not an offense. I remembered when my husband had come to our home before the marriage, he had asked me to sing a song and appreciated it. It is nothing like that, mother explained. Just the natural anxieties of a mother, you know. Do you know it was my harmonium you played while you had started to practice singing? I had brought it with me to your father's house. I played it and sang it to its tune occasionally in the loneliness of the house when my mother-in-law went on her brief visits to her village. So it happened one day that your father came home from early from office and heard me singing. Is singing so important to you? Can't you do away with it? He had asked. There was an unmistakable tinge of disapproval to his voice. I was secretly willing him to say a few words of praise, but this unexpected reaction dampened my enthusiasm. What is wrong with singing? I asked. Ka chit ganvati sati. This is a Sanskrit proverb. A woman who sings is rarely chaste. He had replied, not looking at me. I never ever touched the harmonium since that day, mother said, tears in her eyes. I was speechless. Judged by the male constructed moral parameters, a woman with an artistic bent of mind is an adulteress? What an analytical method to define chastity. Mythological characters like Ahalya, Draupadi, Kunti, Tara, Mandodari are regarded as epitomes of chastity in our culture. Probably, the concept of chastity, defined through the conduct of those role models, had transcended the limits of all physical desire. Male ego always demands a wife's total submission and total surrender. But a woman is not supposed to expect any such commitment, even in its minimal proportion from a man. She is not supposed to dedicate herself, even in her thoughts, to anything else, even to art. The society will stick on her the label of unchaste if she does so. Come what may, I would not discontinue the practice of singing. I had promised to myself on that day. Something which began as a protest had become over the years a sustaining factor for me. And now singing is synonymous with my surviving. He had understood it, and therefore he said that singing was my passion. But my husband had never tried to accept it that way. As I slept in one bed with my husband, I reflected upon the absurdity of the man and wife relationship like this. Two people living in two worlds widely separated from each other will spend night after night in one room, in one bed. How strange. So the story goes like this. It may appear a little, strongly protesting, but it's not like that. It goes in a, takes a topsy-turvy way of a woman all through her life, her journey through singing. So that is...
Here we are talking about, if I could put it in a real harsh word, infidelity. Right, but that is not infidelity in today's word. I mean, they could call it like emotional infidelity, or say emotional dependency on somebody else. But here she again mentions that many a times a woman, her passion, be it with somebody or something or some art, it is always try to be controlled. Is that what you wish to say through this?
It is not that fidelity or infidelity is the question in this. It is, the question is that a woman pursuing her passion. The woman is an artist. She wants to pursue her passion, and she naturally lives two lives, and the other life has not been very kind to her in doing so. Probably, maybe because she's a woman, maybe she has, the world expects her to do other duties rather than this. So she has developed a relationship with this person. The relationship is little platonic, as you had gone through the whole story. So this relationship is basically what is an utopian thing for any woman who is a creative person for that matter, or any woman, that you can see in Krishna and Draupadi's relationship in our myth. So it's not that we are talking about it at the moment now. It was always there. So some relationships are undefined, inexplicable, but they enrichen your life in such a way that it gives you a thrust to go ahead in your journey.
One more thing I noticed about all your stories is all the women, you know, they are very inquisitive. No matter which era they come from, there are stories about grandmothers, there are stories about mothers, there are stories about new age women and girls. But everybody, one thing that I have seen is inquisitiveness in them. Either they put it forward or sometimes it's just in their mind. But do you think all women are inquisitive by nature, but some are like, some hamper their inquisitiveness over a period of time?
When a writer picks up a character, being it a human being, or being a woman or a man, you know, some part of her is being written there, and there is an insatiable inquisitiveness in all of us. So life is basically a flow of that. And my characters in different strata, you know, in this Alone Together, there are two women, two friends from childhood, a girl who has discovered that she is suffering from leukoderma when she just finished her class 10, and the other girl is normal. So how their lives had, they have traveled in their life. The topsy-turvy kind of path the girl in leukoderma had taken, and the straightforward path the normal girl had taken, and they are meeting in a later part of life when she, both of them have crossed 60, and they are assessing what have they got and what have they not got in life, and what kind of philosophy they have got into. So, you know, like without any guile, without any regret, without any, you know, inhibitions, with a very firm and committed mind, women also want to work their life. So that is probably the core theme of each of my story, where there is a woman who wants to live her life once again at the age of 65. And there is a talk about a girl who is a young girl of 6-7 who is brought up in a slum. I mean, what is humanity to her? What is sensitivity to her? Being so oppressed and being always been discriminated because she's a girl child and she's brought up in a slum. And there is talk of a queen, story of a queen who is...
That has fantasy,
yes, fantasy
and realism.
Yes,
both
basically,
in that, yeah.
You know, a woman with such highest power also feels so alone and so alone in her life. So,
despite being a queen, I'll just interrupt. Despite being a queen, she has everything that one can desire for. But still, there is a part of her that needs more. Like, she's ready to run away from the life. Not, I wouldn't say run away or escape. She deals with that life, still wants to live something else that she has her heart set on. Like, not everybody is into diamonds, but what she wants, she considers it very precious. Yeah.
Talking about which story?
About the queen,
queen,
the fantasy,
queen,
yeah.
Queen, basically, I tried to base it, take a medieval time, but the, basically it's a woman in power. What does a woman in power look for? It does whatever is there around the kursi, as you say, and the crown, is it everything for her, and does it satisfy her core inquisitiveness, as you said, the core quest, the core wanting of her for a life of fulfillment? Probably that is what I tried to explain.
So in all the stories, I have seen that there is a certain kind of fulfillment each woman wants in her own way. You cannot say that, by surety that this is what I'm giving you and you have to be happy with this, or say this is your happiness. I think each individual, or should I say each woman, should have the right to choose her own happiness and fulfillment.
See, you know, it's a life which flows like a river, and whether you choose it or don't choose it, it goes on. And here are the stories of some persons. It just happened that I have chosen women to be protagonists, and but it's basically their life, their commitment, their, you know, aspirations. This is what in different strata, as I so told, is a small girl, a woman with leukoderma, a queen. I mean, it's basically a very variety of protagonists I have tried to deal. And since those stories, I believe that fall into a pattern naturally, I had taken it, you know.
Coming back to, it's not just about women alone, there are men too, trust me. And there are stories about them too. There is one story that is also very impressive out of all of those, that is called Scarred. In Scarred, there is this man who from his childhood, after an accident, he keeps thinking about his brother who dies at 15. He is, we can say, haunted. Can I call it haunted? By the memory. But over a period of time, after he gets married and he has children of his own, he moves on. But then there is his mother. Yeah, Paramita, you share this.
Well, it's a long story. This is basically two brothers. The elder brother was 16, is an artist, is into drama and all. The
you
father
don't give
like
in.
It.
They will not going to buy the book.
and this is basically the younger brother, because of his prank, the elder brother dies in an accident. And this haunts this brother for a very long time, all through his life. But slowly he smothers and he gets into the groove of life and forgets. But the mother, their mother doesn't forget. Yeah. That is how it is.
That is how it is. By the end, you realize that the boy who was worried all the time, haunted about the memory, how he moves on and how very subtly and beautifully put that the mother still remembers. There is nowhere a sign in the story when you read that, you know, you're talking about the lost son. But by the end of it, you realize how women feel and what they feel. I think that is the beauty. And if you have any questions, in short, I would like to tell you this book is about inquisitiveness of women, their desires, some unfulfilled, some fulfilled. And it talks about their fantasy. It talks about how everyday women and women who are at the top position feel and desire things. So anybody questions, any questions from anybody here? Any question you have about women, you can ask Paramita. Okay, I guess they are going to read the book or possibly have their own perception about women. Yeah, fine then. You want to close it with anything you write to read down a few lines? Should I read down? Yes, I will read down my favorite lines here. One second. Okay, let me give you a small window before I read out what I want to say. There is a conversation between a man and a woman where a man is saying that women are uninteresting after a certain age, whereas that doesn't die with men. Well, let's see who agrees. Here it is. Who doesn't know it? Because smile back. Do women about 50 have any charm to draw the interest of men? This man should meet Chobade and, of course, Paramita. Again, I'll take a break and say Paramita is Commissioner of Income Tax. And, yeah, you can see the balance in art and her profession. Sorry, I'll continue with this here. Do women above 50 have any charm to draw the interest of men? But this is not the case with men. Age has nothing to do with their desire. The older they get, the stronger is their desire for younger women. Maybe what you say is true, the female says. Older men may be needing women of younger age for their desire, but what does not imply that an elderly woman loses her attractiveness? Do you think that a degree of woman's charm is measured by her physical desirability? Yeah, well, that is it. That's a question left to you. And I don't think it is meant to be, but to know what the protagonist feels about it, like I said, you have to read. I am personally really, really promoting this book because it's a superb book. You can't lay down. Thank you so much. Here, Namita S.Kalla in conversation with Paramita Satpathy. And it was wonderful having you all here despite the weather. Thank you so much.
We wish to thank our speakers, Paramita Satpathy and Namita S.Kalla. Paramita Satpathy will be signing her book in the book signing area left to Darbar Hall.